The word rivalry doesn't do it justice. The Iron Bowl. 75 years of animosity, ecstasy, and heartbreak. Humble beginnings. Legendary figures and unforgettable moments. And just when you thought the heat was at full throttle,
Alabama wins its 13th national championship.
McElroy has Hanks. Touchdown, Alabama.
He's got lots of Kirkland. Touchdown, Auburn! The kick is good. Auburn wins!
This year, it's Alabama's turn. The Crimson Tide in the national championship hunt. But Auburn would like nothing better than to ruin Bama's season. The 76th Iron Bowl, next.
Stadium on the campus of Auburn University. And first on the field, the Tigers. 14 straight at home. Last loss here to Alabama. Speaking of the Crimson Tide. We welcome you to Jordan-Hare for the 76th playing of the Iron Bowl. The Home Depot, SEC, on CBS. It's the Crimson Tide against the Auburn Tigers. Current BCS standings, LSU, they'll stay in number one after their convincing win yesterday. Alabama currently second. Arkansas will drop. Oklahoma State currently fourth. The new BCS standings will be revealed, of course, tomorrow night. Good afternoon, everybody. Vern Lundquist, Gary Danielson. Alabama needs a win to stay in the conversation for that BCS title shot. And Auburn would like a win to continue, make it two in a row in this rivalry game, and we're the privileged ones to be here.
Yes, we are. And I was in these rivalry games, different type of rivalry games, but they're all about the same. It's about your teammates. And when teams are close together, it's about family and seniors and not being the weak guy in the link. This game has meant so much to so many of these players, and we're going to wonder today, who will it be today? They say these games are not about talent. We're going to find out.
We have the last two national champions on the field, and in each of these games, quarterbacks have played huge roles.
They really have. Two straight years. Clutch play by the quarterback has been the difference. 2 years ago, Greg McElroy cemented his legacy as a national champion quarterback with a tremendous drive at the end of that football game to win. And how about last year? That fourth down pass by Cam Newton finished off the game and an improbable comeback for the ages for Auburn on the way to the national championship. Today, two guys. Which one of these two guys will make the clutch throws, or will it be someone else?
And for more, let's go down to Tracy Wolfson.
Coach, the theme since last year was never again. How much is this game about redemption?
Well, you know, it's really about, you know, us playing our best football. We need to play our best football game of the year. Offense, defense, and special teams. Everybody on the bench with great passion and energy. Show what kind of football team we are and what we want.
Thanks a lot. Good luck today. Vern?
And Gene Chizik, head coach of the defending national champions, his third season. picture-perfect afternoon. 67 degrees, winds south-southeast at 11, and those mostly cloudy skies have parted, and we have a severe clear right now. 19 of the last 23 games decided by 10 or less. And this one is always, always special.
How about special for us, though, Vern? How about our opportunity, back-to-back days, to do two games that we're doing like this?
Absolutely. Auburn won the toss. They have deferred. So Alabama will get the opening kickoff. Now, Cody Parkey kicks off for Auburn. He's second in the SEC, third in Division I in touchbacks. And he just adds to that total. That's his 32nd touchback of the year. And time now for the starting lineups presented by Chick-fil-A. Let's begin with the quarterback, A.J. McCarron.
Well, against LSU, he had three or four opportunities to win the football game. You got to believe, as he walks out here today for this, he's ready to finish this one.
First down 10 from the 20, Trent Richardson. Big day for him, very much in the conversation for a Heisman Trophy this year. He is the running back. And a flag flown. That's a pre-snap call.
Prior to the snap, false start. 76 offense. 5-yard penalty. First down.
Matt Austin is our referee. Jones, Warmack, Vlahos, McCullough, and DJ Fluker up front. Marquise Mays, Smelly, Richardson, Michael Williams, and Darius Hanks.
How about Alabama was going to open up with a pass there?
It looked like it, didn't it? First down, 15. Smelly splits out wide to the right. Hand off Richardson. Great defense. And now let's introduce you to the Chick-fil-A defense for the Auburn Tigers. Lemonnier, Whitaker, Carter, and Igwe, the front four. Fella in the middle, El Toro Freeman, has had a sensational second half of the season. And in the secondary, Davis and Thorpe, Whitehead gets a start for the injured DeSharvin Bell. Brandon Gibson, one of the seniors for Alabama, makes the catch on second down.
You have to believe Auburn was hoping the crowd noise would affect the communication for that Alabama offensive line. They're one of the best in the country at talking to each other and figuring out their blocking schemes.
Third down, 9. Blitz. McCarron. It's short of the first down. The catch is made by Brandon Gibson, but Alabama will be forced to punt.
So it was the first down offensive line illegal procedure that cost the three and out. You see, the Auburn zone blitz, and it was a successful play, but because it was third and long, not enough.
That brings on Cody Mandel. And the deep man for the Auburn Tigers is Quan Bray. Fair catch. Called for and taken at the 31-yard line. Well, now let's introduce you to the Auburn starting lineup, brought to you by Chick-fil-A. Clint Mosley got his first start on the road at LSU. He replaced Trotter at halftime of the game against Florida. Had a tough opening game with six sacks against LSU, but came back the next week and threw for four touchdowns.
He did, but Georgia also gave him problems. It seems the big size rushing front fours have given Auburn problems.
Quick flip out to the left side. That's Quan Gray, number four. Lester was up defensively. Green, Slade, Dismukes, Sullen, and Brandon Mosley, no relation. Emery Blake and Lutzenkirchen, two of the keys. McCaleb and Dyer will split time at the running back. And Quindarius Carr completes the starting offense. Now Kyle Frazier is in. We just had a feeling we might see a lot of him today. Much more the runner than the passer, and he hands it off to Michael Dyer. And that brings up a third down, and defensively, they top the country in a variety of categories. Williams, Chapman up front, Harris, Hightower, Nico Johnson, Courtney Upshaw, the linebackers, Menzie, Lester, Mark Barron, the All-American, and Dre Kirkpatrick at the corner. It is third down and three. Mosley back in.
Going to be a quick snap here. Watch him break and snap.
Play action. Mosley steps up. Chase got him. Damian Square, number 92.
You got to know, if I know, Nick Saban and Kirby Smart knows, right?
You think?
You could see Auburn with that sugar huddle. Tried to get a wheel route to the outside to Reed, but it was covered. And you've only got one choice against these guys. When you try to pull it down, you better run quick.
Well, I don't want to scare you, but I knew.
That is scary.
I just provide the platform. Okay, Marquise Mays is back. It'll be Stephen Clark, who has had a wonderful year. So is Marquise Mays, for that matter. At punt returns. Oh, this is a beauty. Wow, taken by Mays at the 13-yard line. And he counterpunches out to the 30. There is a flag now.
And Mays handled that well, Vern. That is really a sun field here. I was out there looking up. He was looking right into the sun. I think there was a late block from behind by Alabama.
During the return, block in the back, 33 of the receiving team. 10-yard penalty, first down.
That's Trey DePriest, the freshman linebacker. So three and out, three and out. Alabama's got it back for the second time.
LG, as a proud NCAA corporate partner, presents great SEC rivalries. It's all about tailgating, flag waving, drink shaking, face breaking, hill racing, celebrating, trash talking, no mistake. It's that love of spiritual, ritual kind of passion.
All
day, it's the way Saturday in the sun.
Seventy-sixth meeting in this Iron Bowl rivalry. Auburn won the first back in 1893. And I recognize number 34 in those highlights, and guess who's on the sidelines? That was Bo Jackson, one of the great athletes in football or other sports.
Suit him up.
Yeah. He has maintained close ties to the Auburn program. One of the great settings in all of college football. Jordan-Hare on the campus of Auburn University. Alabama second possession, first down and 10. Kenny Bell is on. Here's the sweep right. That's Marquise Mays, and that one doesn't work very well.
Well, you wonder about Alabama running the ball and how patient they will be. The last 2 years, this Auburn defense has held Alabama to 73 yards in 2009 and 69 yards last year. Now you look out there, if you're Jim McElwain, you know Auburn's had problems at the corner. Will he stay and be patient running the ball?
Jim McElwain, the offensive coordinator for the Crimson Tide. Three wides to the left side. Chris Davis looks like he might be coming from the corner. He's not. He's just in contain. And here is Richardson.
Yeah, what a player.
El Toro Freeman.
El Toro Freeman has changed this defense for Auburn. He and Darren Bates, number 25. Freeman is so quick to the ball. He just, now you not know he's got to be looking at for Trent Richardson. So when he sees it, he shoots the gap and gets in there and makes the tackle.
Beautiful. Freeman with 22 tackles in the last four games. He was not a starter until midseason. Third down, 7. Darius Hanks comes to the right side. McCarron back, delayed blitz, and this is Smelly. And he's got enough for the first down out to the 30-yard line.
Yeah, and that was an effort first down. That was defended pretty well by Auburn. They were looking for screen there. They got screen, but Smelly just takes a play here that should have gotten 3 or 4 yards and turned it into a first down. Big play by Brad Smelly to move the chains.
Chris Underwood, backup tight end. Splits way off to the left. Now he starts in motion. First and 10. McCarron with a lot of time. Deep down the middle. Man, oh, my goodness. Wide open receiver Michael Williams. I'm not sure what happened.
Well, they run that 4 vertical that time. But to run the ball deep, you have to protect up front. This Alabama offensive line, nice pocket there. Nobody in McCarron's face, and really doesn't get it. You see the tight end's going to go right down the hash here, and Williams and McCarron are not right on the same page.
Second down, 10. Draw. Richardson battles his way across the 35, down at the 37-yard line.
Well, one of the great players we've seen in college football in a long time, Trent Richardson.
I mean,
he plays with such intensity. I think that's the first word that comes to mind when I watch him play, his intensity.
Richardson, in his junior season out of Pensacola, Florida. Same high school that produced Emmitt Smith for the Florida Gators. Richardson now comes and sets up alongside McCarron on third down and 4. Crossing pattern underneath, it's Smelly. His second catch and second first down achieved for the Crimson Tide. Jonathan Mincy, number 6.
The subtleness of the Alabama passing game. They do a bunch formation right here, but watch the pick for the tight end coming across. You get all those guys real tight and then pick when he comes across. That's all you need. Half a yard and an easy throw and a first down.
Kenny Bell, the speedster, is top of the screen, number 7. Marquise Mays is up on the line. Here's McCarron, wide open. It's Michael Williams, the tight end. And Chris Davis makes the tackle. So Alabama, the first team to move now. They've marched into Auburn territory at the 45.
Second down, 2.
McCarron with a good start, 5 of 6 for 40 yards, but the one he missed could have been a 40, 50-yard gain. Second down, 2. Richardson. He's got the first down at the 41-yard line.
Well, we talk about his intensity, but a lot of people have intensity. He's got talent, too. And when you put it together, you look at these type of stats against some of the best rush defenses in college football. He scores touchdowns, and he's dependable. He does not put the ball on the ground.
At the beginning of the game, one fumble in 583 touches. The last time he lost it, the only time in his career, sixth game. Here's the toss back. And they've got Kenny Bell open deep. Touchdown, Alabama. Kenny Bell, sophomore, Rayville, Louisiana. Chris Davis came up to defend the run, and Bell sped right by him. Jeremy Shelley for the extra point, up and good.
Eye discipline. When you're covering a guy and it's a first down run, you know your whole defense is thinking about run, but your job is to let those 10 guys play run and you play pass. It's a flea flicker, handed off to number, the big running back, and one step inside. Just a lack of defense, discipline by Chris defense, Chris Davis, and all of a sudden you've got Kenny Bell running right by you for seven points.
Strikes first, nine plays, 81 yards, took 4.5. And Kenny Bell from A.J. McCarron on that last drive, 4 of 5, 68 yards.
Well, you know that the Auburn defense was saying, we want to stop Richardson. Can we stop Richardson? Well, you know, they committed 10 guys to do it. You can't commit 11.
No. That brings to mind John McKay's great line about his offense. I was thinking you might no. want to commit 11.
Right.
McKay once said to Tampa Bay after they'd lost 26 games in a year in a row, what do you think of the execution of your offense? McKay said, I'm in favor of it.
Right.
Kate Foster will kick off. Quan Bray and Ontario McCaleb are deep.
Bray misjudged that. Landed on the goal line. That should have been caught.
Coming in December, Showtime will take you behind the scenes of Army and Navy football with a new documentary, A Game of Honor. Watch exclusive online episodes at cbssports.com/honor.
Well, you have to believe that Auburn, and I don't think Gene Chizik would say this, but Auburn has to be a bit fragile. They've been, you know, blown out in some games lately. And then Alabama goes for the deep ball. How will they respond? Oh, look at this. Mosley split out wide. The tackle's way out here.
And Kyle Frazier is on the field. Quick screen, left side. Quan Bray. Out of all that, they didn't get much. Let's go back to the studio for this John Hancock update. Here's Tim Brandon.
All right, so Michigan finally gets off the schneid against Ohio State. Braxton Miller's going to be picked off by Courtney Avery to secure the 40-34 victory, strengthening their BCS at-large possibilities in Brady Hoke's first year. Back to you, Bernie.
All right, Tim, thank you. Alabama up 7-0, the old flea flicker. And here's Mosley.
They only had 10 men on the field. That's why you see that last guy running out there.
That's when you want to commit 11. McCaleb. Sweep right, flag down at the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, that'll be, I assume, an illegal formation. I talked to Gene Chizik on the field before, excuse me, I talked to Gus Malzahn on the field before the game, offensive coordinator for Auburn. I said, what are you going to do? He says, we want to slow it down. I know you don't believe me because I'm an up-tempo guy. We're going to slow it down and throw the kitchen sink at him. Well,
just as long as you don't catch your finger in the garbage disposal, because that's what they've been doing so far.
Yes, sir. Offensive coordinator and quarterback coach at Auburn, of course, was...
Illegal formation on the offense. 5 men in the backfield. 5-yard penalty. Repeat second down.
Getting a little explanation. On the near side, second down and 9. Emery Blake comes off the bench now on this one, number 80. That's Trevon Reed in motion. Mosley drills it, overthrows the receiver. Intended for Emery Blake.
Yeah, and Jesse Williams, number 54, kind of affected that throw because he got in on Mosley just as he was going to let it go. Watch. See, just as he was going to throw that ball, he could never step into it. That's why the ball sailed. Now, when Mosley and Chapman and Damian Squire are putting pressure on your quarterback, that's a problem because they're not the rush guys. The rush guys usually come from the outside or the linebacker blitzes.
Third down, 9. Play clock is down to 2. They call time.
Time out, Auburn. The first time out of the half.
Third down, 9 when we come back. Auburn trails by 7. Wednesday, Lady Gaga and music's biggest stars perform live at the Grammy Nominations Concert. LL Cool J hosts and performs Wednesday, only CBS. Split wide right, Jay Wisner in his first year at Auburn. Young wide receiver from Bozeman, Montana. Third down, 9. Hand off Dyer. It'll be fourth down. C.J. Mosley, number 32, up to stop that one.
You wonder about that one, don't you?
Yes.
Take a timeout, get back out there and run a dive that really had little chance of getting the first down.
So Marquise Mays back to return the punt.
You can see from his shadow just how much of a sun field he's in right there. He's looking right into it. 12 o'clock shadow, see?
Yep. Stephen Clark.
And it's a punt downwind here, too.
Short one. Wow.
Oh, no. That might not even get a first down.
Shank.
That might not even get a first down. It did by 4 yards.
Yeah, 18-yard punt. Wow.
And you know if you're Jim McElwain right now, you're smelling and you might be able to put this game away early.
Here's Stephen Clark. He boomed the last one. This one, oofta. 18 yards. That'll bring a smile to the face of Marquise Mays. Jordan-Hare Stadium, capacity just over 86,000. Promise you every seat is filled today. First down 10, Alabama, A.J. McCarron, 6 of 7. Clint Mosley, 2 of 3. So, decided difference in the output so far. Eddie Lacy, number 42, the backup tailback is behind McCarron. Play action. Pulls up. Oh, he's got a man wide open. Brad Smelly
Goats into the end zone for the touchdown. What did you just say?
I said he's going to go for the home run ball. Tight formation. Crossing route and then sneak the tight end down the other side. A little bit of a sneak and then wheel it up. How about that design play? Instead of sneaking and going shallow, you sneak and go deep.
Jeremy Shelley. Take another look at it.
Talked to Jim McElwain before the game on the field, Vern. I said, Jim, what are you going to do? He said, I'm going to avoid field goals, go for touchdowns. Good strategy.
No, that took a while. One play, 8 seconds, 35 yards. Brad Smellie listed as an H-back, tight end H-back, and blocked at the line of scrimmage, released late, wide open. 14 points for the Crimson Tide in 2 minutes and 8 seconds.
All right, I'm going to do my best here, okay?
Okay.
In 2009, Alabama trailed 14 to nothing, came back and won.
Okay.
2010, Auburn trailed 24-0, came back and won.
I remember that.
A good omen for Auburn. Good omen for Auburn.
Yeah, remember a year ago, the Crimson Tide have not forgotten. Signs plastered all over the locker room, never again. They were up 24-0 and lost to the national champions in a classic 28-27. Of course, Nick Fairley is on the sidelines of this game now, not in uniform. And Cam Newton has gone on to some degree of acclaim. Here's Kate Foster. Quan Bray and Ontario McCaleb.
Well, that's real short.
Wow. McCaleb grabs it at the 15-yard line. And then looks like he might have slipped as he neared the 30.
Well, when we were prepping for the game, Vern, one of the things I thought Auburn could hang their hat on is a little bit of option last week gave this Alabama team some trouble, rush for over 300 yards. I said, would Auburn do it? I talked to Kirby Smart, the defensive coordinator, on the field before the game, and I said, Kirby, why did you schedule these guys triple option? And he went, when we signed the contract, they were a passing team. They switched after we did the contract. We'd have never played those guys.
Kirby Smart, defensive coordinator, one-time teammate of Will Muschamp. This is Kyle Frazier. Courtney Upshaw with the tackle.
Well, as you watch this Alabama defense play, just understand that their stats are better than anybody in the country, and they deserve it. I've talked to numerous coaches in this conference, and they said these guys are just different. They stop the run up front, their linebackers run 53 yards wide, and their secondary can play man or zone, and they have the scheme that could throw in any game, and Kirby and Nick do a great job of taking away what the offense does best.
6 yard gain on the first play in this series, and here is, oh, nothing doing.
Well, when you get ready for Auburn, you know that they're going to do a lot of different things. So you have to go to basics, and that means sound tackling and run the guy down with the ball. And when you get pressure on a quarterback from your non-blitzing guys, that means your secondary can stay back, and you're not going to make those mistakes. You let your front seven handle the run. You let the secondary handle the pass.
Trey Mason is in motion. Gets the handoff, goes around the corner.
Good call.
Yes. Mason, a 5'10 freshman, true freshman.
Yeah, one of the interesting things about coaches who talk about Alabama is they said you must try to run wide on them. Even though you might not be successful, it's almost like throwing deep with incomplete passes. You have to spread them out a bit and understand they all aren't going to work because that's the only, you can't let them set inside on you.
That is the first down for Auburn.
Reverse.
Reverse.
Look at that discipline.
Wow.
Alabama stayed home, and Trovon Reed has stopped Jarrell Harris, number five.
Well, when you're playing against this type of a offense by Gus Malzahn, you know all week the coaching point has been stay home, stay home, stay home. Look for the reverse. Look for the trick play. Jarrell, I tried to take that circle off you. I couldn't get it done. It's working hard.
It doesn't help when you slip either. Mosley back in, and he is under center. Second down and 13. Fake the draw, fired out to the right side. Phillip Lutzen and Kirkin. And he gets five back. Mark Barron makes the tackle.
And it's Mark Barron late on the field. Everybody last year talked about the punched-out fumble as the big play of the game, and obviously it was a big get play. But I think the injury to Mark Barron was really the difference in the football game last year. He played with one arm. I watched the tape of it. He was a warrior out there, but actually two of the touchdowns could have been made by Barron had he been healthy. He could have stopped them.
On the sidelines now, and it's third down and 8. Mosley pressured again, gets it out on the edge. This is Trovon Reed, and he is stopped short of the first down. Daquan Menzie gets up limping a little bit, number 24. Looks like he's going to be okay.
Did you hear the crowd on that play? I mean, they're going to go four down here. They were so excited about that play, and it picked up, what, 4 yards?
Yeah, well, 4th and 3. And Gene Chizik and Gus Malzahn say, well, we're down 14. We're at home.
Well, they might pooch punt it here.
Yeah.
Well, they might pooch punt this.
That's it, exactly. Oh, very effective.
I don't mean this negatively at all. That was a really nice pooch punt. But when that's been your best play by your quarterback all day, that's not good news.
No. This former NFL star always had drive, but can he take the checkered flag? It's an all-new amazing race tomorrow after 60 Minutes on CBS. When's the last time you saw a team quick kick?
I've seen it. I actually have seen it a number of times. Michigan used to do it a lot of times.
Uh-huh.
It's a third down tactic,
right,
when it's third and long. I think I saw Brady do it, to tell you the truth.
Goodness. Eddie Lacy is the running back. This one tipped.
Uh-oh.
Fumble. Scramble. Who got it? Auburn got it. Kenneth Carter, number 92. Corey Lemonnier forced the fumble.
McCarron in the pocket takes one pump too many. When he takes that second pump, he doesn't have the ball security, and Lemonnier makes the play.
Cody Parkey on for the extra point. And just like that, Auburn's on the board.
And Gene Chizik will sell this. He needed something in this game to get his players believing that they could make a play to win.
14-7. Number 55, Corey Lemonnier. Mom and dad both born in Haiti. He is now a product of Florida, calls Hialeah, Florida, his hometown. Leads the team in sacks, and he forced that fumble. That's number 5 for the year. And Alabama is a team, Gary, that doesn't fumble. That's their 4th of the season.
Now, you got to wonder what Jim McElwain, the offensive coordinator, and through Nick Saban, the coach, what they're going to do with A.J. You give them a call like that, first and 10. You got to expect your quarterback to have ball security. I'll give you a good play, but you got to bail me out. You can't give me a bad play. Will they now go a little more conservative, or will they stay wide open?
4 seconds remaining in the first quarter.
I assume on that play that Lemonnier beat Barrett Jones.
I think so.
Now, you know, part of it was McCarron taking too long to get rid of it, but boy, that's a disastrous first down play.
And if that be the case, Barrett Jones, an All-American tackle. Here's Parkey. There's another one sailing through the end zone. Well, actually 9 yards back. Marquise Mays will take a knee, and it'll come out to the 20-yard line. Here's McCarron. Fourth lost fumble of the season for the Crimson Tide. None more costly.
You know, in this league, nobody feels sorry for you. You got to climb back in yourself. Let's see if Auburn can climb back in. There's one step. Now they got to show they can stop it.
Fred Richardson again remains on the bench. We'll get Tracy Wilson on that one right away and see if there's an injury involved. Handoff, Lacey. Between the 24 and 25. And we've reached the end of one with the score 14-7, Alabama. We'll return to Jordan-Hare Stadium after this message and a word from your local station. You're watching the Home Depot SEC on CBS. Here at Jordan-Hare as we begin quarter number two. Vern Lundquist, Gary Danielson, along with Tracy Wolfson. Looked like Alabama was really in control, and bingo, one play.
You just keep playing hard when you're out there. You just keep going and going and going. Watch the fumble out to the right side. Barrett Jones is matched up, does a decent job, but when McCarron brings the ball down, then the opportunity is there. When you keep hustling like Lemonnier did, you have the opportunity to change this into a football game. Nothing good has happened for Auburn so far in this football game. You say, are they going to feel sorry for themselves, or are they going to make a play? Come on, it's a rivalry game.
Exactly. Second down six as we begin quarter number two. Corey Lemonnier with the big play, forcing the fumble. Recovered by Kenneth Carter. 14-7. Eddie Lacy is still the running back. Marquise Mays bounced outside after a very modest gain. It's going to bring up third down.
Yeah, that was defended very well, very aggressively that time. Well, didn't take, we don't won three and out, and then they found the deep ball. Unfortunately, the last one play drive went the other way.
Third and four.
Lemonnier and Jones right there. There's that matchup again.
Got Kenny Bell. He's out of bounds at the 31. Second catch for Bell.
You know, to the layman's eye, it looks like Alabama runs a very simple, conservative offense. But when you talk to the defensive coordinators, they say something totally different. They say these tight ends, the way they align them, whether they go wide or tight or unbalanced or shift or motion, creates all kind of problems on the edges on how to keep from getting outflanked.
And again, Richardson remains on the Alabama sideline. Here's Eddie Lacy on first down, out to the 31-yard line. El Toro Freeman, number 21.
Yeah, 21 and 25. They almost made the tackle together that time. They have been difference makers. When they are freed up, when they have any space, they run it down. When they moved Freeman inside, he has been a star. He played well in this game last year, too, by the way.
McCarron, 9 out of 10. But all of that weighed against the fumble recovered in the end zone. Here's McCarron. Pressure from the outside. He steps up. He's got Lacy. And it will be third down again. Jonathan Evans, number 35, makes the tackle. Here's Richardson. Missed a couple of series. Tracy, anything important involving Richardson?
Well, he's fine. There's no injury to report. He remains on the sideline. I was told that every third or fourth series they get Lacy in, and now he's back in the game, guys.
Okay, Trace, thank you.
This has been the formation of the day. They start out wide, they shift in, and then they move from there, the two tight ends.
Timeout, Auburn. A little jawboning going on with Richardson and Darren Bates, number 25.
Yeah, Bates kept coming after the whistle on the outside blitz and ran by Trent, and Trent just kind of elbowed him.
Second timeout of the half. It'll be a 30-second timeout.
Now, time called here. That gives us a chance to go back to New York. Here's Tim.
All right, Vern and Gary, Logan Thomas has contributed to both touchdowns for Virginia Tech today, and a winner-take-all for the ACC Coastal here to Jarrett Boykin to make it 14-0. You know, if the pollsters don't want to see an all-SEC final, this is one of those teams that could be sneaking up along with Oklahoma State. Vern, back to you.
All right, Tim, thank you.
Oh, yeah, I forgot all about that all-SEC title stuff. I was only reminded about it like 500 times as I walked over here. But
yes, yes.
And they all were in that crimson red. Don't blame them, though.
Gene Chizik.
Isn't it crazy?
Nick Saban.
3 straight years, this football game could determine who's in the national championship game.
Richardson in motion. McCarron, smelly. And that appears to be enough to move the chain.
That was such a nice catch. Smelly had to adjust to this ball. It was not thrown perfectly. Watch how he fades and makes it look better than it was. Look at that. Caught it right off his back of his helmet. He had to fade and catch it at the same time. Oh, I just love throwing to those big tight ends like that.
Well, he's a hometown kid from Tuscaloosa. His older brother, Chris, at one time was a starting quarterback at South Carolina. Wound up transferring back to Alabama and played baseball.
Yeah, here it goes again. The tight end's way down here in the flanker position. Really stresses your rules as a defense.
McCarron goes right side and misconnects with Underwood.
Another tight end.
Yes. Second down, 10. Underwood near side, so is Kenny Bell. Now Underwood moves in tight to the left. Draw play. Oh, brother! Ouch. Darren Bates and Trent Richardson.
Well, Trent hurdles a player first, and that exposes him for Bates. When he was in midair, that's when Bates cleaned him up. When he goes up, tries to jump away from one tackle, it exposes him, and that's the way it is. Trent will just line up and say, give it to me again.
5 for 19 now for this, Richardson.
This is feeling like a rivalry game now. This is really feeling like we were hoping it would be.
McCarron finds Brad Smelly again. Look at the stiff arm on Chris Davis. And Smelly fights his way to a first down inside the Auburn 30-yard line.
If Alabama knows you're playing man-to-man, they will pick you every time. I didn't really see it very clearly, but I assume Mays comes across and picks. Yep, that's exactly what he does. Just enough to throw that defender a half step. I had my eyes in the backfield, but you can almost guess what the play call was.
And it results in a first down 10, 14-7. Alabama leading. Draw play. Richardson. His sixth carry.
He won't go down.
No.
But he made the first down.
No. Look at Blahos.
I literally think there were 10 Auburn players at the end of this tackle. In the secondary, gets stopped, good defense. Now watch this. All 10 defenders, one guy was behind the play, and the 10 other guys on the tackle.
Picked up 11 on that carry, 6 for 30 now. Marquise Mays, number 4, comes in motion. Go back to Richardson, bounces again, but good pursuit by the Tigers, and it's a gain of a couple. Kenneth Carter, Nosa Igwe, numbers 92 and 94, defensively. Well, play of the drive. Eaton up 5.5 minutes of the second quarter. McCarron deep in the end zone. Kenny Bell was held up. There's the flag. Yeah, Jonathan and Chris Davis was beaten badly on the play. And reached out and grabbed Kenny Bell.
Yeah, Chris Davis having a tough start in this football game. He can't get frustrated now. You got to forget it. If you're playing defensive back. Now, was the ball overthrown or was it catchable? Might be the question.
Pass interference. Number 11 of the defense. A 15-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
Down at the bottom right there. Man-to-man inside technique. You can't take that fake. Ted Roof lined you up inside and said, don't get beat inside, and he still did.
And so after the penalty is marched off, the ball spotted inside the 5-yard line.
Remember the pass last year? Trent Richardson dropped one down near the goal line.
Mm-hmm.
Changed the ball game, and then the turnover.
Play fake. McCarron. Richardson got it. Goes for the end zone.
Not this time. He scored. He didn't drop that one, did he?
No. Almost the same play.
Yeah, he stuck his right hand out and took it across the pylon for the touchdown. McCarron was very patient with the ball. He was covered for a second as he slid out to the flat. McCarron said, one, not there. Look for Smelly, not there. Go back to Trent Richardson. He stuck out his right hand to make the play. Just outside.
Jeremy Shelley's extra point is up and good. Trent Richardson now 20 touchdowns on the ground for the season. That's his third as a receiver. Another look. Trent Richardson gets by Jonathan Mincy. A.J. McCarron. 12 plays, 80 yards. All right, listen up. Listen closely.
Where can you find the most beautiful women in the world, along with music performances by Maroon 5, Kanye West, and Jay-Z with Nicki Minaj? It's the Victoria's Secret Fashion Show Tuesday. Only, I promise you, CBS.
You'll watch that, won't you?
I will. That's why.
It's a red-blooded American man. Yeah. Why wouldn't we?
Scoring drive, 12 plays, 80 yards, 5.53. Richardson got the touchdown.
He did. And we asked whether McElwain, following the fumble, would he go conservative or would he keep throwing the ball? Well, he did a little of each. He threw the ball conservatively, and it worked very well for him.
And he's thrown three touchdown passes in the first.
Well, there's no doubting McCarron's talent, you know, and it's a process, and it's playing under pressure. It's playing in big games, and he's got his team poised for great things in front of him.
21-7, 9-11. Kate Foster with the kickoff. Oh, boy. Indecision with McCaleb and Quan Bray, and it bounced between the two of them. Well, coming into this afternoon, here's the look at the SEC West. LSU with that overwhelming victory over Arkansas yesterday. We'll see them against Georgia in the championship game. Alabama with a 6-1 conference record going into this game. Georgia on quite a roll now. Congratulations to Georgia.
Sure, and when you think about it, you know, a loss is a loss, but the one game they did lose to South Carolina, they kind of kicked the ball away from themselves. But remember, with that record, they're the team that did not play the big guys from the other side.
That's right.
LSU and Alabama.
First down, 10. Mosley, incomplete. Trovon Reed. Let's go back once again, check in with Tim in New York.
All right, there is another civil war, right? That's Oregon against Oregon State. Here is David Paulson with a 16-yard touchdown catch from Darren Thomas to make it 14-7. A win here assures Oregon home field advantage for the first Pac-12 championship game, likely against a 500 UCLA team. Back to you.
All right, Tim, thank you. Second down, 10. Kyle Frazier is in the backfield. Option.
Now, we did talk to defensive coordinator Kirby Smart about the possibility of Frazier. He said, do you expect Frazier? He said, well, I'd play him if I was them after somebody ran 300 yards on me. He said, we practice more against Frazier's look than when we normally would because the plays don't show that he would play that much, but we overcommitted expecting that we would see him.
Kyle Frazier out of Springdale, Arkansas. And Gus Malzahn from that same city. Third down. Third and four. Frazier.
Upshaw gets Frazier. Welcome, Kyle Frazier, to the SEC.
In honor of the late Smokin' Joe, down goes Frazier.
He did. And he didn't have any time this time. There was no chance, no one to throw to. When Upshaw came around the edge and Jesse Williams inside, I don't care how good of a running quarterback he is, he wasn't going to get away from that one. Boy, Jesse Williams is getting to be a monster inside.
Mm. Number 54, Williams. Here's Stephen Clark, 18-yard punt last time out, remember? Marquise Mays, fair catch, called for. Grabs it at the 35-yard line. Home Depot SEC on CBS will continue after this word from your local station. In the aftermath of last year's Iron Bowl game, Auburn's victory, an Alabama fan named Harvey Updike is alleged to have poisoned
The 125-year-old oak tree's at Toomer's Corner. They're in dire danger. For more, here's Tracy.
Well, Vern, I went by Toomer's Corner, and if you look at the trees, they look sickly. Usually they have green leaves on them, and they are almost bare. They said they will not know until the spring at the earliest if the trees will survive. The tradition, though, of rolling the trees with toilet paper after a win has continued, but now the paper is hand-picked from the trees instead of power-washed. Also, there is increased police presence, especially this weekend, guys.
Yes, indeed. We drove by there on our way to Jordan-Hare today. It's a very sad sight. Alabama leading 21-7, 7:40 to go. And McCarron has not missed much. 13 of 15 so far. Trent Richardson, stiff arm. And he's
The last one will bring a flag.
It is.
Yeah, it did.
Corey Lemonnier.
I didn't see the flag, but it will bring it. They gave the second push, but the third push they were going to call it.
Following the play, personal foul, 55 in the defense, late hit out of bounds. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
Lemonnier is hustling across the field. There's one push. That's okay. Now he's into the white. That's. You know, Lemonnier was trying to stop, but his own momentum carried him into Richardson there. And, you know, you're in charge of your own momentum and body in that situation, and you've got to pull off the best you can.
First down at the 45, 21-7. 7:20 to go before the break.
Here's that formation with both tight ends split out wide.
Four-man Auburn rush. McCarron pumps once, goes short, and Richardson has it go right through his hands. But McCarron, that one goes on Richardson. He's had a great first half.
Yes, it's been a well-called game and a precision accuracy from McCarron. He's made one mistake holding on the ball in the pocket, but he has been on target, he's been patient, and he's delivered. He's really grown. I mean, now I think he has earned the confidence of his coaching staff in big games. They're going to have, we said it all year, I've been saying it all year, you ain't winning this championship without having great quarterback play, and now he's risen to that level.
Second down, 10. Richardson comes left. Tackled at the 42-yard line. Nico Thorpe, number 15, makes the stop.
Number 25, Darren Bates. Play game four, third down six.
Well, you wonder how Nick's going to play this. Will he play it four down territory? Remember his problems kicking field goals.
I do remember those.
Or will he say, whatever, we're going to have to kick a field goal sooner or later in our next game. So if we have to kick it, we kick it. Interesting call here.
Third and six. Draw play. Richardson.
Mute.
First down.
The question's mute. Lead draw play. Just follow those big offensive linemen. Give it to your All-American running back. Just foul the number 65, Warmack, right around the turn right there. Richardson gets his shoulders up front and dives across the line.
10 for 47 yards now.
A lot of shotgun, isn't it?
Yes. Lacey is on the field. First down, 10. Sweet. Nothing. Jeffrey Whitaker, number 54, with the tackle. Dave's the People's Choice nominee. Monday, don't miss Twilight's Robert Pattinson. Then catch Craig Ferguson right here, only CBS. And a player down. Looks like it's Nico Thorpe, number 15. And so while the medical staff is out tending to Nico Thorpe, we'll step aside. Once we reach halftime, that's 5:27 playing time away. We'll go back to New York. The Geico Halftime Report. Tim and Spencer have been joined by Tony Barnhart today, and they'll get you caught up on all the college football action as well as preview the SEC Championship. That's all coming up on the Geico Halftime Report.
Nico Thorpe, fortunately, was able to get off the field under his own power. It was a helmet-to-helmet. Nico slipped a bit, and Eddie Lacy was kind of pushed into him. And you can see the helmet-to-helmet, left side of your screen. Boom. Almost right in the forehead. Now remember, Ken, as you look at Nico Thorpe right there, 21-7, 5 minutes, as Vern told you. Can they get out of the half, Auburn? They get the ball to start the second half. Can they stop it and keep it a football game, a two-possession game?
Second down, 9 right now.
Second down, 9 from the 32.
Ball at the 32-yard line.
These tight formations is when Alabama loves to do their play-action passes and force those defense to iron out where everybody is.
Richardson looks for blocking help. He cuts it inside.
Well defended.
It sure was. That'll bring up third down. Gives us a chance to check in with Tim once again.
All right, fellas, got another winner take all in the leaders division of the Big Ten. Russell Wilson is a couple of Hail Marys away from being a legitimate Heisman candidate. Watch him get away from pressure here against Penn State. And this run is going to set up a 2-yard touchdown run by Monty Ball. It's 21-7 Badgers over Penn State. Back to you.
All right, thank you, Tim. Right here. 3rd and 7. Alabama, 6 of 7 on third downs here in the first half.
See, you never know about Alabama. So unpredictable. You think they're going to go shotgun, they go under center.
And they call on Richardson, who will be stopped short at the 25. And now we see the field goal unit come on the field. Memorably, 2 of 6 in the overtime loss to LSU. They're going to apparently go for it. It would have been a 42-yard field goal. Shelley's longest this year is 43, so they'll go for it on fourth down. Play action. Into the flat, it's caught by Smelly. What a first half he's having. And a first down.
The clock was running down with the shift and the motion. And interestingly, Nick Saban was running down trying to call timeout. He didn't get there. Nick's not as fast as he used to be. He kept a timeout, but good thing he's slower than his younger days, because that trot didn't get him there in time.
He was clocked at 4-4 in the 10-yard dash. Smelly has caught 6. Up the middle it goes to the 15-yard line. And we near the 3-minute mark. Take a look at the Verizon Red Zone stats. Alabama, you saw the statistic. It's 2nd down.
Will they try to go after Chris Smith again? He's had his problems out there, number 11. Chris Davis.
Play action. McCarron pulls up, fires into the end zone for Marquise Mays, and it's overthrown and incomplete. A good job of coverage from Jonathan Mincy, number 6.
Third down.
End of this throw here. The ball was thrown to the outside very safely. And goes right in, and it's...
Oh, my goodness.
Well, if you're going to run into somebody.
Oh, dear.
Third and six.
Brad Smelly, right side. And Richardson is stopped short. Now, will they call the field goal unit, or will they go for it? Jeremy Shelley almost, for the season is 14 of 18.
If they didn't go field goal here, if I was the field goal kicker, I'd say he's avoiding me. They got to go field
goal. You think?
Yes.
Yeah. So here comes Shelley. He's had one blocked. That was against LSU. 14 of 18 for the season. This will be from 30 yards. A.J. McCarron is the holder. Perfect. Lead now 24-7, Alabama.
Tim Brando in New York coming up with the Geico Halftime Report. Spencer, Tony, and I will get you caught up on all the action, including for the first time since 84, Kentucky beats Tennessee after Taito Smith intercepted Tyler Bray to seal it. A double whammy as Tennessee will not go bowling. Now back to the Iron Bowl.
Thank you, Tim. A shocker. 10-7, Kentucky. Wow. Alabama, 12 plays, 51 yards, just under 6 minutes.
I got to tell you, those Tennessee people take their football seriously there. That is a shocking score, and I wonder if there will be ramifications.
Legitimate question. Kate Foster will kick off 24-7 with 1:44 to go before the break. Thus far, the Auburn Tigers have one first down. Their touchdown came on a fumble recovery in the end zone. Fumble caused A.J. McCarron let it go when hit by Corey Lemonnier, and Carter recovered it. Here's Kate Foster. Vaughn Gray, number four. Just across the 20. If you ate too much on Thanksgiving, they may be to blame. Inside the secret flavorist business. Plus, she's one of the biggest stars in the world, and tomorrow Angelina Jolie is on 60 Minutes. Look at this. 37 plays, Alabama 15, Auburn.
33 yards. You know, Alabama's defense is number one in the nation in allowing first downs. Only 10 per game average. They've got one. Auburn's got one.
Mosley. Hand off to Dyer. Dyer with over 1,000 yards this season, but held in check here this afternoon.
You know, I don't know if I've done an Alabama game, you know, all year when or watching them, where I go the whole first half, have a dominating defense, and don't mention Dante Hightower's name.
And you haven't really mentioned Courtney Upshaw.
No, one sack. Yeah. One sack by Upshaw, but that's how dominating the front has been. They can't even get to the second level.
Second down here with 1:05 to go.
Well, that didn't get to the second level. They got three timeouts left, does Alabama.
Courtney Upshaw.
Kind of surprised Nick didn't call one here. Third and long. It'd be really hard to believe that they could pick this up.
Third and 12. 34 seconds to go.
They're going to bleed as much as they can.
Yeah,
off the clock.
This is really interesting. Are they going to leave the field with three timeouts in the pocket? Hmm. 17 seconds left. That was Nick Gentry, who was chasing Mosley.
And Gentry is kind of one of those guys you don't talk about enough. He is a pass rush specialist, but he doesn't look like it. He just spins around and makes plays, and they're going to get a rough intentional grounding, right?
I think that is going to be the call.
I'm sure Alabama will go for a block here,
There's
but
no
you never know.
For intentional grounding. The ball crossed the line of scrimmage, out of bounds.
Long, long day for Clint Mosley.
Well, that line of scrimmage goes to infinity all the way as far as it can, and you can get it across the line of scrimmage even if it is out of bounds. Will Alabama go for a return here or a block?
Well, fourth punt now. That average includes one of 18. Here's Stephen Clark.
His turn.
Nice. Marquise Mays grabs it at the 30. Reverses field. And is caught and dropped. And that will be the final play of the first half. A.J. McCarron led the way 24-7 as we get ready to go to the break. And let's check in with Tracy.
Thanks a lot. Coach, just one first down in that first half. How do you get something going offensively?
Well, we're going to have to go in there and talk about it. We get the ball coming out in the second half. We're going to have to make some adjustments. We definitely got to move the ball offensively. Defensively, we're playing okay at times. Can't get off the field on third down right now.
Last year, you were down 24, though, and came back. Will you bring that up at halftime?
We're going to keep fighting. This is this year. That was last year. We're going to keep fighting.
Thanks a lot. Vern?
Tracy, thank you. We've reached the end of the first half, 24-7 Alabama. Now let's go to Tim Brando in our New York studio.
All right, Vern, coming up on the Geico Halftime Report, Spencer, Tony, and I will have all of today's action, including a couple of winner-take-all matchups with trips to conference championship games at stake. After this word from your local station.
As we get set for the start of the third quarter just a moment ago. Tracy Wolfson with Nick Saban.
Coach, a near-perfect first half. What were you most pleased with?
Well, I just think, you know, we challenged our players to play the best game, and other than the one play that we fumbled the ball and got sacked, I think we played pretty well. But we also said we want to do it for 60 minutes. And that whole never-again thing was about this score at halftime. So what are we going to do in the second half? So we got to play a whole game.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Tracy. And, of course, never again refers to what happened in this game a year ago.
And I think Nick got the score he wanted to sell to his team, 24-7, the same score.
A.J. McCarron had a pretty decent first half.
He sure did. And when you got a hot quarterback with the power that Alabama has, A.J. McCarron started out with the flea flicker. You call it, you get him open, but you still got to complete it. And he did. One perfect throw. Smelly was wide open on the throwback pass. He made one mistake. Pulled the ball down one time. That one mistake led to 7 points. But he made up for it. He went for Richardson right there in the second quarter, but you know what? This time Richardson didn't drop it. The trends, talked about McCarron, Trent Richardson, they didn't need him a lot. Had the one reception. Look at the yards for Auburn. When you're going up against this Alabama defense, you better bring it. And I was reminded at halftime that when you look out there for Auburn, I don't see a Cam Newton or a Nick Fairley here.
Ooh. Well, we mentioned earlier, Nick Fairley is among those on the sidelines today. And Cam Newton, otherwise occupied. Cade Foster will kick off. Quan Bray and Ontario McCaleb are the deep men for the Auburn Tigers, trailing 24-7.
Remember what happened last year? It was a long pass that kind of take it from this score into a 10-point game real quick. That was the one where Barron couldn't lift up his arm.
Mm-hmm. Short kickoff taken by McCaleb near side.
Oh,
this
play.
Is what they wanted. Foot race. Ontario McCaleb. Touchdown, Auburn.
Just talked about the big play that changed the whole dynamic. of the second half. Looks a lot different down 10 than 24-7, doesn't it?
Oh, my goodness. Cody Parkey is on for the extra point. 83-yard kickoff return. And Auburn has cut it to 10. And they do so on Ontario McCaleb's kickoff return. 83 yards. And it's 24-14. Nick Saban. Wow.
Nick Saban was telling Troy DePriest that he went the wrong way. Okay, let's see what DePriest did on the play. He said you went the wrong way. See when he went outside to his left, right there. He should have been filling inside, and Nick was very upset about that. Nick was yelling to Priest, you went the wrong way.
And in part because of that movement, Trey DePriest caught the ire of his head coach. That is the first kickoff return touchdown for Auburn ever in this series. How about that?
How about that? And can you blame the Alabama coach for being upset? One first down and 14 points.
Cody Parkey will kick it deep. Dean Milner is one of the deep men. Marquise Mays is the other. And again, Parkey third in the country in touchbacks. Boom.
The short kickoff for Alabama, they do not have the depth on their kickoffs. They do not get the easy touchbacks.
I look at the difference in those two kicks.
Yep. Well, it is downwind, too, although yeah. It does look like the wind has died a bit here, just looking out.
First and 10 from the 20 and a 10-point margin. Into the flat, caught by Michael Williams, the tight end, number 89.
Well, you can really see the Alabama coaches believe their best matchup is throwing the ball.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they may run the ball if they get to the end of the game to put it away, but they believe the best way to score points is through the air.
Second down six, Kenny Bell, Marquise Mays, to the left, the two tight ends, Smelly and Williams, come right. Quick flip, Marquise Mays. And he is hit by Jonathan Mincy, number 6. Well, the Crimson Tide, look at the first half possessions. 3 and out, but then after that, with the exception of the fumble, it all was well done. That's a pretty big exception.
Yes, sir. That's true. Yeah. That was a nice job by Mays that time, getting a first down. Looked like he was going to come up short, but he kept his feet and made the first down.
Richardson left side. Nice cut. Down the sidelines and tackled finally.
Yeah.
At the 33.
He does not go out of bounds either, does he? You just follow the pulling guard. Who is it this time?
McCullough.
It's McCullough this time, number 52. He fits it, and then, whoop, right out to the outside. And watch him keep that ball high and tight. High and tight. I'm not going out of bounds. Great run. Great blocking that time, and he pops it.
He's getting very close to 600 touches with one fumble in his career.
He's very disciplined with that football when he runs.
35-yard gain on the last play, first down. Look at that little stutter step. But nice defensive job by Nosa Igwe to make the tackle.
Give this one to Ted Roof, defensive coordinator for Auburn. He brought the corner cat. That's what stopped the play. The jump stop was against the corner that time. Chris Davis came in, forced the delay, and stopped the play.
And a player is still down for Auburn at the 35. Time has been taken. Gene Chizik out. We'll step aside.
The Home Depot SEC on CBS is sponsored by Verizon. Reese's Peanut Butter Cups. New York Life Insurance Company. And by Delta Faucet.
24-14, the injured player was Chris Davis, and he got up and walked off unaided. NFL tomorrow, doubleheader for you on CBS. Lead game early, Buffalo at the New York Jets, and the lead game late, New England at Philadelphia. It all begins with JV and the quartet. The NFL today, 12 noon Eastern, presented by Southwest Airlines. There's Chris Davis. They were paying attention to his, looked like his right leg, but he appears to be just fine. Second down, 11. Richardson, by the way, is closing in on 100 yards on 15 carries. He's got 96 so far. 3, split wide right, play action. Inside route to Marquise Mays, and he dives inside the 30 and is tackled at the 27-28. Corey Lemonnier with the tackle. Third and 4.
Remember what Gene Chizik told Tracy right after the half. We got to get off the field on third down. Let's see if they can do it here.
Richardson bangs his way over right tackle, still fighting for yardage.
Okay, that's like Earl Campbell right there. That's
You're right.
Earl Campbell-ish, isn't it? Well blocked up front. Second level, and he won't go down. My goodness.
Ninth 100-yard rushing game this season, tied for the most with Mark Ingram in the national championship year when Ingram won the Heisman. Here's Richardson again. Knees down about the 10. Nico Thorpe, number 15, with the tackle.
When I talked to Ted Roof, the defensive coordinator, about this game, I said, Ted, what are you going to do? And he said, well, we don't have enough strength to take these guys on. We've got to penetrate and make some plays in the backfield, like that Chris Davis play when the corner cat.
Right.
They have not got enough of those plays, not enough negative plays to stop Alabama.
Bell and Marquise Mays split to the left. Richardson behind McCarron. Play clock at 5-4-3. Ooh.
Didn't get it.
Didn't think so.
Nope. McCarron was trying to get the ball from the center.
Yeah.
But Vallejos didn't see him.
Part of the snap. Delay of game. Offense. 5-yard penalty.
Well, you've got a great player, and you can throw the ball, you can run the ball. And he catches it also. And you know the great thing about him? That ball security that you see right there, when you give it to him, you know he's not going to give it to anybody else.
Second down, 12. That's the fourth penalty on Alabama, second on Alabama. Richardson hit from behind and dropped. Big third down coming up from the 12-yard line. That was Nosa Igwe, number 94. Made the tackle.
Here it is again. Third down.
Mm-hmm.
Just remember, we haven't talked about this a lot in this game. Alabama's not just playing Auburn. They're playing Oklahoma State.
Yep.
They're playing Virginia Tech. They're playing Stanford.
Darius Hanks goes in motion to the left. Here's McCarron. Here's Marquise Mays trying to go inside again. And he is dropped at the 12. Jeffrey Whitaker.
Wide receiver screen. They were successful before. Watch those linemen come out to the outside, but defended from inside out that time. Jeff Whitaker did a great job of finding it.
So Jeremy Shelley, who has kicked one from 30 yards, is on for his second attempt today. 28 yards. A.J. McCarron will hold it. They got three to answer Auburn's seven. 27-14 with 8:47 to go in the third. Sonic celebrates creativity in the SEC. One of Auburn's shining stars this season is freshman running back Trey Mason. But while Trey thrills crowds on the football field, his father, Vincent, better known as DJ Maceo of the Grammy-nominated hip-hop group De La Soul, thrills audiences on the stage. And for Trey, he views his dad as a luminary for how he wants to live his life.
I look at him as my dad. He's just a father figure to me. But as we go to concerts and things with him, I really realize who he really is. And I just look into my future and see, like, I want to have that effect on people.
Alabama's scoring drive, 10 plays, 69 yards. It took 6:02. That's their third scoring drive today of 10 plays or more.
I wonder if DePriest is even out there right now.
Well, we open this third quarter with Cade Foster's very short kickoff taken by Ontario McCaleb.
I don't see him.
In contrast to Cody Parkey of Auburn, Foster for the season only three touchbacks. And as Gary pointed out, there is a wind.
Yep, he benched him on the kickoff.
Wow. This is McCaleb again. Going right. Foster knocks him out of bounds. You think special teams are kind of significant for both teams in this game? That's a 38-yard return from McCaleb. And it's time now to bring on the Duck. Time for the Aflac trivia question. Who was the first Heisman Trophy winner born in the state of Alabama?
Wow, born.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what, if I was a kid that lived down in the southeast and I could kick it off into the end zone,
yeah,
I would be calling Nick Saban right now.
I think so.
I'd say, Coach, let me come there. I can get it into the end zone for you because those short kickoffs are really stressing field position.
Kyle Frazier is the quarterback on first down. He goes right. And the tackle is made by Vinny Sunseri, number three. His dad, Sal, is one of the assistant coaches here, and his brother, the starting quarterback for Pittsburgh.
And he's getting a little more playing time because Will Lowry is injured for Alabama.
Now,
Mike Dyer, very quiet in this game.
Mm-hmm.
Three rush attempts. Remember when Auburn beat South Carolina and carried the ball 41 times.
Into the flat, Quan Gray. And that's D. Milner, number 28. Dante Hightower was in the neighborhood. Well, 14 points for Auburn. One on a fumble recovery in the end zone, the other on a kickoff return. They're still looking for their second first down of the game.
And I believe they'll take two opportunities to do it.
Michael Dyer's late getting onto the field. Kyle Fraser will take this 5 yards back. Kyle Fraser, it's going to be fourth down. Well, two touchdowns. The first. Lemonnier causes the fumble. Carter recovers it in the end zone, and then McCaleb electrified this crowd with an 83-yard kickoff return to open the second half. And Stephen Clark is going to come on fourth down and one.
And Alabama will play a defense safe. They'll make sure this ball is punted. There'll be no return on. They'll just play defense here. Chizik is thinking this over. He may want to go for this.
Gus Malzahn to his right.
He went right to Gus Malzahn and said, I've got second thoughts here.
Well, next Saturday, CBS Sports tips off our 31st road to the Final Four with the two best teams in the country, Harrison Barnes and North Carolina, visit Terrence Jones and the Kentucky Wildcats, the season premiere of NCAA basketball on CBS. Now then, fourth down. 27-14, 6:49 to go third quarter. Wait and see who comes back.
Yeah.
On the field for Auburn here.
That's the guess. Who comes back? Is it a run or a pass? Which quarterback? Will they go fly motion? What will they do?
You know, I just looked down there and see number 80, their leading receiver, Emery Blake. I don't think we've called his name once. Zero catches.
And none last week either against Samford.
Mosley is on. They will go for it. Fourth down and one. And Mosley under center. Michael Dyer, first down. That's the second first down in the ball game for the Auburn Tigers.
He almost had to go for this.
Yep.
Went under center, follow inside crease. Chad Slade is the guy, number 62, that pulled around and found a little crease for Dyer to follow.
Kyle Fraser back in. There's the option, the pitch. Whoa! Watch out, McCaleb. It's still loose. And McCaleb did fall on it.
Oh, he had the play, too. He had the pitch. With McCaleb's speed, it could have worked. The pitch was behind McCaleb a bit. Fake? Play? Pitch? No, a little head. I'm sorry. Stuck his hand out and didn't catch it.
That's a loss of 10, second down and 20. Mosley back in.
Crazy formations again. Double pass.
Kyle Fraser, he will throw it. Goes deep for Lutzenkirchen. Incidental contact at the 5-yard line.
Yeah, heads up by Dre Kirkpatrick. Really didn't fool the Alabama defense. Kirkpatrick's here, but when he sees Lutzenkirchen go down the middle, he just fills in as the last safety. He just play football.
What's his name?
Lutzenkirchen. Right?
Of course.
We've had him enough.
You stumbled a little bit. Just a smidgen. I just think it's fun to say.
Yes, it is. It's fun to watch him play, too.
Yes, it is. Philip Lutzenkirchen. Now Mosley looks over to the near side. Lutzenkirchen is split off to the right side. There he is. His sister Ann, one of the three sisters, working for us in the truck, and she said you had it absolutely right.
Lutzenkirchen. I actually spent about 10 minutes on the field with Philip And I said, what do you notice about the young guys? He said, what I tried to do is warn them about this game, even telling them about Tiger Walk. It's going to be the biggest Tiger Walk. Control your emotions. Save your emotions for the game.
And, of course, Phillip was one of the heroes of the come-from-behind win last year. He caught the go-ahead touchdown, invented a little impromptu dance in the end zone when he caught the pass from Cam Newton.
When is Hightower going to make his play?
Mosley in trouble. Throws it away. Vinny Sunseri was following Mosley all the way. And so fourth and 25. It was the errant pitch from Kyle Frazier to Ontario McCaleb that got them in trouble. Now then, Stephen Clark.
Yeah. You know, everybody says, why don't you just run the option offense like Georgia Southern? Well, that's something you have to practice every day, off-season, spring ball, every time.
Alabama's called time.
And they had 12 men on the field. Nick was very upset. You see behind him, Bobby Williams said, we're trying, Coach, we're trying.
This is the most American game played. When we graduate, we'll be on the same team.
But when we're on that field, we do not like each other.
They're there for a special reason. It's not just about the football.
That's A Game of Honor, premiering December 21st, only on Showtime. And a special behind-the-scenes look December 3rd on CBS. And in 2 weeks, we'll be in our nation's capital for the Army-Navy game. That's a pretty sight, isn't it? Not that. I was talking about the moon. Marquise Mays is back. Stephen Clark, a Ray Guy finalist. This will be his 68th punt of the season, and 30 have been downed inside the 20, and this will be another one. Unless. Oh, yes!
Nice play.
Wow!
McCaleb, wasn't it?
Of course! How about that?
Man, had some hand-eye coordination there. He slips, and like a shortstop, just flips it back. Now, that is a wonderful play. And this is where the turnover, this might be just where they want him.
Stephen Clark, as we mentioned, a Ray Guy finalist. Brilliant punt. He's had one really awful moment today. He had an 18-yarder, a shank, but that was terrific. And how about the play by Ontario McCaleb? A kickoff return to open the second half for a touchdown. And now that heads-up play forces Auburn to begin from the 3-yard line. Remember, one of the two touchdowns was a fumble recovery in the end zone. Handoff. Richardson got a couple. Let's go back to the studio for this John Hancock update. Once again, here's Tim.
Vern, I've got another great back that's not getting any love for the Heisman. Monty Ball, 18 yards of the rushing touchdown. It's 42-7, Wisconsin. His 34th touchdown of the year. They're headed to the Big Ten title game. And if these two scores hold up, Virginia Tech and Oregon are headed to their conference title game. Back to you.
All right, Tim, thank you. Second down, 8. They'll try Richardson again. Nice job. Look at him. Look at that. I tell you, it's so much fun. We've gotten to know him, of course. He is a Doak Walker finalist, as well as he's going to be in New York for the Heisman presentation, I'm sure. Soft-spoken young man. Really been a pleasure to get to know him even just a little bit this year. 3rd and 3. Richardson, of course. Nice job defensively. I don't think he got it.
No, he didn't. and that last fumble down there for 7 points, and the inability of Auburn's offense to muster anything, I think had Nick Saban telling Jim McElwain, run it for a first down,
right,
or we're
going
to punt it on fourth down.
And so Cody Mandel comes on to punt for only the second time.
Before they start playing Oklahoma State, they got to beat Auburn.
Yeah, that's a, you're right. Mandel. Quan Bray is the deep man, and he takes the fair catch at the 43. All right, I know you've been waiting for this. Cue the duck again. You bet. Who was the first Heisman Trophy winner born in the state of Alabama? Answer, Pat Sullivan. Born in Birmingham, where he now coaches. And won the Heisman here at Auburn. First down 10, Mosley.
Well, can Auburn find a big play on offense? They've gotten a big play on defense, big play on special teams that you've talked about. Can they find one tricky play on offense?
Dyer darts to the outside. Boy, what a nice move. Vinny Sunseri. And some injury updates. Let's check in with Tracy Wilson.
Well, guys, you mentioned, when will Dante Hightower make a play? Well, he's dealing with a left elbow injury that he suffered in the first half. Also, safety Mark Barron, who was injured last year in this game, looks to be slowed by a neck injury. He is playing in certain situations, but I was told don't expect to see him out there every down, guys.
Okay, Trace, thank you. Draw play. It's Dyer again.
And that's why on that first down play, it was Sunseri that made the tackle. That's where that we would have seen Mark Barron before.
Right.
So it's Lester and Sunseri as the safeties.
Milner and Dequan Menzie on the corners. I did not see Drake Kirkpatrick. Yeah, there he is, top of the screen. Kyle Frazier, third and short. Trey Mason around the corner. Enough? Ooh, how about a little help from Vinny Sunseri on the spot?
I think it's close. I don't think he got it.
I don't think so either. It's fourth down.
And if you went for it last time, you got to go for it this time, right? And there's Hightower.
Yep.
No, and look at Sinceri's pointing to the spot on the turf.
Fourth and a foot.
Better hurry up.
10 seconds. They're going to have to call timeout. Five.
Timeout Auburn. Their second timeout of the half.
That wasn't pretty.
Well, they had a spread formation, and then they had to go to their short yardage formation, and it was just too hard for them to do.
Now, Red Lobster presents today's Scholar Athlete. It goes to Stephen Clark, the sophomore. Grade point average of 3.21 and a Ray Guy Award finalist. Red Lobster's commitment to the investment of our future is shown today by donating $1,000 to the Auburn General Scholarship Fund. So Auburn now with one timeout remaining. 98 seconds to go here in the third. Kirby Smart saw a shot of Gus Malzahn, the offensive coordinator, just a moment ago. Malzahn. Wary of lip readers up in the coach's booth. Ladarius Phillips is on as a halfback. Okay, here we go. I don't know.
Boy, didn't that seem a little too cute by half that
yes.
time? I mean, they picked it up just running a normal ISO play last time. And Kirby Smart got hit just about as hard as the play on the field.
Here's Dyer.
Yep.
Right?
Somebody was over the top. Was that Hightower? It was Hightower over the top. His elbow might be hurting, but his legs are propelling him.
Wow. Launching pad.
And that took too long, and it was timed up too well. And Kirby, emotionally, is going to get it the other way. And takes a chest bump.
And so first down, the ball goes over on downs, 27-14, Richardson. Jonathan Evans, number 35, with the tackle. Nosa Igwe, whose name has been called a lot today. Number 94 was also there. Igwe, a Texan, Mansfield, Texas. Second down and four.
You know who this Alabama team reminds me of? Is that 2002 Ohio State team that won the national championship and beat Miami, that high-powered Miami team, when no one thought they could do it? They grounded out. They played great defense. Did it with punts. Different style, but very effective.
Richardson. Gang tackle. Stop. May have lost. Well, he got the line of scrimmage back. It's going to be third down. Jeffrey Whitaker, number 54, and Corey Lemonnier. Third and five.
So does Ted Roof come after the quarterback here? Got to figure they're going to throw the ball. Oh, they went end over.
Yep.
Tackle over Barrett Jones. Miscommunication. Barrett Jones lined up on the wrong side and forced a timeout.
And so Alabama is forced to use a timeout. Both teams with one timeout remaining. There's the All-American Barrett Jones, a rare mental mistake for a guy who graduated in 3 years with a 4.0 grade point average. I'm sure he's going to appreciate us pointing that out.
If it was, mind by the guy who was supposed to tell him to go to the other side. Us quarterbacks make mistakes, too.
Following our postgame show on CBS, Gary Danielson discusses this game and answers your questions live from the SEC on CBS Cruiser. Watch the fifth quarter at CBSSports.com/Gary.
You know, done the bus all year.
Yeah.
Did the charter jet last night.
Yeah.
I like the jet a lot better. I don't know what it is. And then we got here. Our producer, Steve Shear, took good care of us with some good hot food. That's all I asked for.
Hope they're listening back in New York, Gary.
Oh, yeah, you can put my picture on a jet anytime you want.
Third and five.
Behind him.
Intended for Brad Smelly. And that'll force a punting situation now.
Had a matchup he wanted.
There's Ted Roof, defensive coordinator. Darren Bates, number 25, is...
still a football game here, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Quan Bray is at the 10. Fair catch. Taken at the 9. Final play of the third quarter. It's the end of three. We will return to Jordan-Hare Stadium after this message. And a word from your local station. You are watching the Home Depot SEC on CBS. We begin the start of the fourth, Alabama leading 27-14. It's now time for our Home Depot Tools for Success.
Auburn, how do you hold a team to 44 yards after three quarters? You recruit some great players who can run, and tackle and produce a scheme that Nick and Kirby Smart has designed, and then you make third down and fourth down stops just like that, and Kirby Smart says, that's the way we do it here.
Well, they're in the number one position in five categories defensively. We're seeing a pretty good example of that.
Well, yeah, they there's no secret here. You watch Alabama play, you know they're a great defensive. I don't care what the stats say. You just watch them play, you know that they would be effective against any offense. They've got guys in the secondary that can cover. They've got a great scheme. Even right now, they're playing without Mark Barron again, like last year. They bring on another guy who's ready to go in Sunseri.
Kyle Frazier is the quarterback. Play fake. Deep down the middle. Or down the right side, I beg your pardon. Ray Kirkpatrick defending. It was intended for Emery Blake.
One of the things when you watch Alabama play on tape, you say, are they susceptible to play-action passes? Really, no. Because the secondary knows the front seven will handle the run game, so they play it safe back there. They're not going to get beat deep. It will be a great route to beat them deep.
Mosley's back in now. He pump fakes, goes deep. Lutzenkirchen a little too high. Oh, he was open.
I thought he had another guy open, to tell you the truth. Down the sideline that time. On the fake screen, I thought he had one. A little bit of a bust by Alabama. He went to Lutzenkirchen and could have gone out wide for a bigger one.
And it's third down 10. Mosley 5 of 10. Auburn 1 of 9 on third down conversions. Hightower. He's coming. Mosley goes deep, intercepted, picked off easily. On the overthrow, this is Dean Milner. Dives, touchdown, Alabama.
The third interception for a touchdown this season. Really poorly thrown ball, and you know Milner smells it and takes it right over the edge. Did he step out before? There they are. They're calling him at the 3 yard line.
Ah. The initial indication was.
Are they going for
touchdown?
Two? Are they going for two?
Oh, okay.
Yes. I'm sorry, Vern.
That's all right.
I thought for sure he clearly scored. I was in the middle of that replay and see him lining up for two.
And so.
How about this shift? Big tackle out here in the slot.
Barrett Jones lined up. McCarron back. Oh, my gracious. How easy was that? Michael Williams for two.
You got to check out Barrett Jones on this design play.
He won.
He kind of faked it like a Tom Brady would fake the snap over his head.
Yeah.
I'm going to fake it to the right. Throwback all the way. It's their two-point play, and you can't get it any more open than that. But Barrett Jones had about as much fun as you could on that play.
Let's take another look at the interception. Dean Milner, 35 yards. Mosley, badly overthrown. It looked, it was quacking as it made its way into the arms of Dean Milner. And the dive at the corner, Alabama. We'll be back in Auburn in a moment.
And now it's time for our GEICO game recap.
Here's the first touchdown, Kenny Bell. Second one, Brad Smelly, 35-yard reception. And the fumble recovery in the end zone. Richardson caught a touchdown pass. And Shelley with a 30-yard field goal. Ontario McCaleb, kickoff return. Shelley kicked another field goal, made it 27-14. And then the interception by D. Milner returned 35 yards. And so 35-14. Gene Chizik's team, defending national titleist Jeremy Shelley, will kick off now in place of Cade Foster. Quan Bray and Ontario McCaleb are the deep men, and they're both at the 5-yard line. Along the ground and taken up near the 35-yard line. C.J. Uzama, who threw a touchdown pass earlier.
How about this well-designed play? It's an unbalanced line. There's Barrett Jones. The touchdown's going to come here. But watch Barrett Jones sell the play in the slot. I got it. Look at this.
Oh, my gosh. He thought he was Brett Favre for a moment.
Yeah, that highlight will go forever for Barrett Jones.
Oh, heavens. Kyle Frazier is the quarterback, 35-14. And Frazier will keep it. Comes right. Goes left. Ankle tackled by Vinny Sunseri. Again, Mark Barron injured and on the bench. That's a gain of 12.
The play gains 12 yards. First down from the 48.
We'll fake it to Michael Dyer. Spin move. C.J. Mosley.
As good as Gus Malzahn's offense was last year when he produced all those yards, this year in the SEC without big number two back there, they have only gone over 400 yards once this season. Excuse me, in the SEC.
Mm-hmm.
And that was against Ole Miss.
Second down, 7. Trey Mason, number 21.
Number 21, Trey Mason, the ball carrier. Good tackle by number 30, Donnelly and Hightower.
Hightower with the tackle. Third down.
Third down, 5.
Third and 5. Look at the disparity in yards gained, 309 to 61.
Tackle, tackle.
Mosley finds Quan Bray. And with that lean, he did get a first down. Nice play, Dean Milner with the stop. 35-14.
The play picks up the over first down.
That's the fourth first down of the ballgame. McCaleb, a late add in the running back spot. McCaleb coming right. And knocked out of bounds. Let's go to Tim Brando for this Heisman watch presented by Nissan.
Okay, Kellen Moore tossed 3 touchdown passes today for Boise State, including this 46-yarder on the final play of the first half to lead the Broncos to a win over Wyoming. Tonight, RG3 will try to keep his Heisman Trophy campaign going against Texas Tech. And Andrew Luck and Stanford look for a possible at-large bid by virtue of a win over Notre Dame. Back to you.
All right, and it's second down and 4. Dyer. Lester finally is able to corral him and bring him down.
You know, Vern, as we talk about, you know, remember yesterday, Les thought margin of victory mattered a little bit.
Exactly.
Okay. You wonder right now what margin of victory will determine be a part of this game as people start judging how Alabama will place at the end.
Well, they were number two in the BCS standings. New ones will be revealed tomorrow night. Here's Mosley back. Goes left side wide open. It's Lutzenkirchen.
That was and right on the knee.
Right on his left knee.
Yep. Throwback pass all the way. Just as he takes, you know, he saw the guy coming, but right on his left knee. I thought maybe he didn't get his head around in time, but he had plenty of time to find the defender on that play.
Time call.
The Home Depot SEC on CBS is sponsored by John Hancock Mutual Fund. Sonic. The Home Depot. And by Nissan.
Coming up, we'll have the play of the game presented by Napa Auto Parts. And good news, just a moment ago, here's Philip Lutzenkirchen helped up, but now watch.
And Milner gave him a nice slap as he went by.
Yep.
That's old school there, isn't it? Run off the field. That is old school.
Yes. First and goal now at the 10 after that catch. Here's Dyer on first down, about three.
And Lutzenkirchen's going back in on the game.
Yep. Now let's take a look at the Verizon Red Zone stats. 19 touchdowns, 7 field goals. Auburn inside the 20. Timeout. Guess who was down there?
Prior to the snap. Timeout. Alabama.
That would be the head coach. Showing that 4-4 speed and 10-yard dash.
Correction. Timeout, Alabama. Their third and final timeout of the half.
He's not pleased, is he? Army-Navy game. Our crew will be in the nation's capital, Washington, D.C., Saturday, December 10th at 2:30 Eastern Time. One of the great games, speaking of rivalries, Army-Navy, presented by USAA, 2 weeks from tonight.
Alabama keeps 14 players out on the field, and then they adjust to the different formations when Auburn runs their team out.
Kyle Frazier is the quarterback. On second down and goal. Ball at the 5. Dyer. Nothing. Dante Hightower. And Damian Square, 30 and 92. Third and goal.
Well, knowing you got 4 downs to get a touchdown, Gus Malzahn thought he'd try one more. But you see Hightower over there? He would not allow anything but a give. He stayed at home on the other opposite side. Courtney Upshaw, on the other side of the field. And Upshaw stayed home and allowed Hightower to make the play.
That's Trevante Stallworth, top of the screen. Here's Mosley back, in trouble, down. Fourth down, Courtney Upshaw.
Again.
Disrupted things.
Upshaw last play, stayed at home, and was disciplined. This time, sees the fake, going to have to rush the passer, comes off the edge, and beats John Sullen, number 71, who pulls towards him. See him? He plays the spread, he plays the speed sweep, and then he forces the sack.
And on fourth down, Auburn will go for it. Blitz threatened? No. Mosley, good coverage. Protects the ball down. It goes over on downs. There is a flag down.
There's a flag on the play.
Holding, offense 77. Penalties declined. First down.
It's so hard if you're going to try to throw in the red zone against Alabama because they play combo in the back to keep your backs in, because then that frees everybody up and there's too many guys back there.
9:34 to go in this one.
Well, when we saw the highlight of Boise State, it made me think of my kingdom for a kicker. Alabama missed a kick. Boise State misses a kick against TCU. Oklahoma State misses a kick against Iowa State. If any of those three had been made, they could be controlling whether they play in the national championship. Now, it's going to look like this. Is it going to be Alabama?
Is it going to be Oklahoma State?
Who has to still beat Oklahoma?
Yep.
Or how will the vote just go? Will people just say, I'm not voting for Alabama because I'm against a rematch? Or will people say, I'm watching them play. They're a good football team. I think when they're one of the best two teams in the country, I want to see them play LSU. You can go over all the stats you want. When it gets right down to it, I think that's going to be it. Some people are going to say no rematch. Other people are going to say this team is one of the two best teams.
Yeah. And, of course, two-thirds. The computers are part of the BCS ranking. And you've got the coaches poll and the Harris Interactive poll. Here's McCarron. 9:34 to go. Richardson. Well, the current BCS standings going into the weekend. LSU, their work is complete, but they do have Georgia next week. Alabama, 10-1. They were second. Arkansas will drop. Oklahoma State still has to fake Oklahoma. Virginia Tech is leading, by the way, over Virginia. Big. Richardson, now with 142 yards on 25 carries.
Remember this. Oklahoma State is number two in the computer polls over Alabama.
Right.
You never know. You never know. I don't even know who the guys are that programmed those silly things.
Richardson's 26th carry. Longest run today, 35 yards. He's closing in on 150 for the afternoon. His high for the season, 183, and he's also, that was midseason. He also had a game when he rushed for 181. Richardson comes left.
Oh, my goodness.
Well, you look for a moment, don't you?
Yep.
A defining moment for your career and perhaps the Heisman. Perhaps.
You know how the Heisman, Vern, has the statue of the guy with the straight arm?
Yep.
Watch the Heisman straight arm on this one. And he doesn't pose. He slaps him out of the way. Look at that. That's a Heisman run if I've ever seen one.
57 yards. 57. One of the student managers capturing it. He's got 203 in the ballgame. First down. Eddie Lacy is in. What a run.
Remember when a year ago against LSU, we watched Cam Newton. You know, we're looking at the Auburn uniform.
Right.
And he had that Heisman run against Patrick Peterson right into the end zone to our right, where he accelerated away from Patrick Peterson. That took my breath away. When I watched that run right there, I said, my goodness, and I had the same feeling. I'm watching greatness as he runs.
He's got the tattoos. One of them on his right arm is of his mom, and the one on his left arm is his grandmother. So Trent Richardson. Here's Justin Fowler. Number 45. Yards.
There's a lot of beauty in football. Sometimes it's a pass, sometimes it's just power football. If you love football, you love them both.
...41-14. Shelley. I don't think Nick Saban is satisfied yet.
Yeah, one more look. I don't really need to say much.
Trent Richardson. Michael Williams gets the first key block. Look at that.
Swats away Nico Thorpe right there.
Wow. And Mincy does catch up with him.
He swats away Mincy too.
And celebrations taking place. ...42-14.
In the open, Vern, we talked about desire and passion and dreams of playing in this big game, and sometimes in these rivalry games it can make the difference, but sometimes it's just talent that makes the difference. And in this game, it's been the talent that's made the difference.
Well, I'm reminded of Jay Jacobs, the athletic director at Auburn's expression back in August, because they lost so much off the national championship team. He said, I hope we can win six games. They've won seven.
Yes, I think they've exceeded my expectations for Auburn this year. Yes.
Well, I'm thinking back 2 years ago, and we didn't do the game, but we watched it. Mark Ingram rushed for 246 yards against South Carolina, and he went on to win the Heisman. Well, tonight, Trent Richardson has rushed for a career high of 203 yards. And it comes in a game against your most bitter rival.
Yeah, it's matched up against Andrew Luck, I believe. Okay, and Andrew Luck's going to have a big
stage
high-profile game tonight. And remember, Alabama does not have a game next week. They do not play in the SEC Championship, so they go dark after this.
Yes, there's Dyer. And a reminder to stay tuned for the Jeep postgame show. That's after the completion of our game on CBS Sports. Second and nine. And we're nearing the 6 minute mark. Caleb. Let's take a look at Mark Ingram and Trent Richardson, 09 and 2011.
Alabama goes so long without a Heisman winner.
Yeah.
And then these two guys were in the same backfield. And now they both might be having a Heisman trophy. Remember, if Oregon wins, Stanford also goes dark after this game. That's a very interesting vote. And after this play, I'd like to get on my soapbox about this a little bit, this Heisman.
I was hoping you would.
I'll get everybody else mad at me, right?
Oh, goodness. There's McCaleb coming right.
I'm going to ask the voters to try to be fair to these players. Too many times in this vote, people from different regions will vote for the guy they want and leave off the other guy off their ballot, trying to make their vote count more than it should. Be fair to these two players. If you think Luck deserves it, fine. But you should vote Trent Richardson second. Opposite. If you think Richardson deserves it, you should vote Luck second. They both deserve their due.
Here's Mosley into the flat to Quan Gray.
Used to always bug me when somebody would leave an obvious guy off the vote.
Sure.
Got to give it to Robert Griffin. He has had a tremendous year. Case Keenum, you know, playing a different type of talent, schedule, strength of schedule, but he's a gifted thrower. Those are the three guys. I think it's between the two on the left, personally.
Mm-hmm. Hey, you sound comfortable in that soapbox.
Yeah. Been there before. took a few shots. We'll continue to take a few.
Michael Dyer.
You know, it's sports, right? If we can't argue about sports, we can't talk about anything else anymore.
Right. Well, there is an extreme passion to this game, too.
It is.
Oh, my goodness. Last year, Auburn with the smiles.
And how about the state of Alabama going 3-for-3 in Heisman's with Cam in between?
Reverse, Quan Gray.
There were four Alabama defenders out there.
Quan Gray, tackle for a loss. Number 30, Dante Hightower.
Dante Hightower. Mosley gets up limping. C.J. Mosley.
Second down, 13.
Now, one of the ironies, of course, Gary alluded to it in this, the whole BCS battle now. LSU, they must go face Georgia next Saturday in Atlanta, while Alabama will rest, not have to go through the championship game. There's Dyer again.
Look at that defense. Play another defense that is really coming on. The Georgia defense. They've been able to run the ball with power. Isaiah Crowell is their go-to guy when he's healthy. But they rush the passer. They're big on defense. Jarvis Jones is their sack guy, but it's going to come down to their quarterback. If they have a chance to beat LSU, they better get a game, an A game, out of Murray.
Well, that's next Saturday on CBS, 4 o'clock Eastern time. The SEC Championship. Third and 14. Lutzenkirchen back on the field. They come right. McCaleb. Now, how do you compare these two? LSU ranked number one. Georgia opens the season losing to Boise State and South Carolina. They haven't lost since. They have not faced the powers of the West.
That's right. That's the way you would compare them. You would say LSU has faced tougher competition. Georgia is a good football team. Can they prove it against the big guys?
Mm-hmm. Fourth and two. Under 2 minutes to go. McCaleb going left. Got the first down. Robert Lester makes the tackle. First and 10. Mosley. Left side. Incomplete down at the ankles of McCaleb. If you haven't seen one of the season's most talked about shows, tomorrow's your chance. Catch back-to-back episodes of Person of Interest right here, only CBS.
Well, the person of interest on this football field has been Trent Richardson. I mean, he's just one of those guys you pay money to go watch play.
And people were wondering if he would have a remarkable game on a big stage, and he certainly...
Considering that Alabama, the last 2 years as a team, has rushed for under 100 yards.
Mm-hmm.
He went for 200 out by himself. Now, he had blockers up there, I get that. But he has shown his toughness, versatility, and just an awareness when he's running the ball.
And think back, Gary, to the 9-6 overtime loss for Alabama. Right. I thought Richardson played well in that game.
Oh, he sure did. In fact, seeing the quotes about Trent, he felt proud of the way he played against those tough guys. He said it was a man's game, and 89 yards against those guys, or whatever he had. I think it was 89.
It was?
It was. He was very proud of it.
Mosley. Tackled by Ed Stinson, number 49.
Did the ball come out? A lot of...
Yes, it did. Stinson recovered it.
Well, how about that for this Alabama defense? 42 points on offense, okay? Well, seven of those from their defense,
right,
to be honest. Okay. But they basically pitched a shutout. They got a sack for a touchdown and a kickoff return for a touchdown. They shut out this Auburn offense. And tell you what, you watch them play, you might argue whether they should play in the BCS championship game. I think they will, personally. You can't argue how great of a football team is. It's obvious watching them play.
Now time for the play of the game, presented by Napa Auto Parts.
The interception was the difference in the game. You got to give it to the defense. It was still a game until that play right there. As good as the offense was, that one play typified the dominance of the Alabama defense all game.
Richardson, 203 yards. Gets a hug from Ontario McCaleb, Demetrius McNeil. And let's go down to Tracy Wolfson.
Coach, you said after last year, never again. This team came out, they dominated, and they took care of business and finished. How satisfying was that?
I'm really proud of our players for the way we played today, but, you know, this is great for our fans. I mean, this is a big thing in the state of Alabama, this game. So, you know, I'm really proud of our team the whole year. You know, they gave themselves a great opportunity here today and finished it the right way, and really, really proud of them.
Your final chance, though, to impress the voters. Why do you think your team should play for the national championship?
We weren't trying to impress anybody. We were just trying to dominate the game today and do the best job that we can. We got a great team. We lost one game in overtime to the best team probably in the country. So everybody's got to make their own decisions about all that. But, you know, we got a great football team, and I'm really proud of them.
Congratulations.
All right, thank you.
Vern?
Thank you, Tracy. So for Gary Danielson and Tracy Wolfson, who's got a smile as wide.
For Trent.
As Trent, exactly. I'm Vern Lundquist saying so long from Auburn, 42-14 again tonight on CBS. How I Met Your Mother, followed by Unforgettable and 48 Hours Mystery. 42-14. This has been a presentation of CBS Sports, home of the SEC Championship. We'll send you to Tim Brendo and the Chief Postgame Show right after this message and a word from your local station.